say at this point, but here, Bob, process analysis. World line, SA, at this point. So time crosses Alice lines. World line. And the both of them are just drifting to the right. For some velocity V. And they do this rearranging experiment. And other is this quantization experiment. And so, have no luck. So what does it look like? Well, let's see. So this event over here, down here, here is Bob. Bob has emitted a light signal, which travels over to Bob prime. So at this point over here, Bob emits a light signal, traveling towards Bob prime. So the question is, what does that light signal look like from Alice Allen's prime point of view? How would I draw that light signal? Yeah.
45 degrees. Wow.
That's right. Okay, so this time at 45 degrees. Let me try to draw this reasonably carefully. Okay, so this is 45 degrees. My principle P2. Principle P2 says that the field might be independent of the motion of the source of light.
Bob is moving to the right.
Bob is moving to the right, and Bob is moving to the right. So,
that's...
Team
is
the right. Team is the right. So, actually, that's right. So Bob and Bob actually start over here, but they're drifting to the right. And so, at some point, Bob is winning over Alice, and Bob Prime is pressing with Alice Prime, which is what's happening here. Yeah. Okay, so at that instant, as they're crossing, at one platform, it's like a scaling platform, Bob Prime starts doing this synchronization feature. Bob sends a signal over to Bob Prime, and that light signal travels at 45 degrees, even though he is a source that is in motion. Sorry, so Bob is carrying a flashlight. From Alice's point of view, there's a moving source. Bob clicks on that flashlight, but even though the source is in motion, from Alice's point of view, that light moves at the receiver's light, which is 45 degrees in her diagram. Okay, and then what happens? Then that light signal hits Bob prime and gets reflected back. Okay, so at this point here, Bob reflects it back. So I'm going to draw a light signal going back. At what angle do I run? Yes, absolutely. So if Bob thinks a red light, and what depends? So if Bob, well, suppose that Bob is just a little bit to the left of Alice, then she will see a light signal passing this way, and so the light signal, you see it approaching, so the source is approaching, and so she will see the frequency blue shifted. If Bob were just to the right of Alice, right, then the light goes that way, doesn't seem like it. Okay, so this guy here is at 45 degrees as well. Again, my principle P2. Remember, we're trying to do everything according to the principles. No, okay, thanks. Okay, so we've got this guy 45 as well, even though Bob Prime is in motion, doesn't matter. Okay, so this is also 45. So now what? So tick marks on Bob's world line here, measuring the time according to Bob. How am I drawing? Is it evenly spaced or not? They're evenly spaced. There may be condensation. In fact, there will be. So the tick marks on Alice's world line are close together. The tick marks on Bob's world line are further apart because there's this condensation. But that's not relevant here. What's relevant is that the spacing is even, whatever it is. Okay, so now what happens? What does Bob do? What's the next step in his clock synchronization procedure? That's right. So he counts the total time divided by 2. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay, let's suppose there's 10. 10 divided by 2 is 5. So he's got 10 there. He divides that by 2 and he gets 5. So where's the midpoint of this? The midpoint of this is about there. Okay, so that's 5. Okay, so what he concludes is that's this one here, the event T. And so what he concludes is that this event here, halfway in between, is simultaneous with this event. That's where Bob Prime received that light signal. So he concludes, so Bob Prime would say that these two events are simultaneous. So for them, if we were to catch up with them and stand in their reference frame, at rest with respect to Bob and Bob Prime, those two events are simultaneous this way. Like, we would hear them at the same time if they were, like, snapping finger events. Okay? So, but are they simultaneous for Alice and Alice Prime? So which one occurs first? So here's time according to Alice. Here's 1 second, here's 2 seconds, here's 3 seconds, here's 4 seconds, here's 5 seconds. T occurs first, then there's 6 seconds, and 7 seconds. Oh, T prime occurs. So T occurs at 5 seconds, T prime occurs at 7 seconds. Okay, so for Bob and Bob Prime, those two events are like this. For Alice and Alice Prime, we see Bob and Bob Prime drifting like this. They see this event, then this event. Okay, so that's really, really important, that this idea of simultaneity, when proving they're simultaneous, that depends upon the observer. For me, these are simultaneous. If you're moving relative to A, you will see one first, then the other.
Yeah. The light principle, because that depends on the motion of the source, the light response, right? So in our diagram, the light signal going up 45 degrees is bottom line. And then the Alice's world line is very close, and the angle from Alice's world line is bottom line. It's world line of the other thing, right? Because of the velocity.
Yeah.
So there's no velocity here.
Yeah.
So then, once you, like, by that diagram, it doesn't make us be perceiving light speed to be a red line. Well, she, okay, she is. Because she's on the back. So, this is vertical. This is supposed to be at 45. This is at 45. Oh. Yeah. So, I mean, when I say 45, you're going to the blackboard. You're going to the vertical and horizontal to the blackboard. Okay, so that's that. Okay, so, actually, this idea that simultaneity might not be relative, may not be absolute, but might be relative, or depend upon the observer, was first suggested by Poincaré, and then a little while later, it was Einstein who actually understood it concretely what this means. Okay, so what this means is quite radical. Okay, it's quite beautiful, the consequences of this. All right, so let's look at this quickly. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Bob's x-axis. So we know all about Bob's time axis, right? So in these pictures that we're drawing, that's Bob's time axis. This is the time, according to Bob. You take more samples along those axes, right? So this is C through Bob time, and so on and so forth. Okay, so we know all about time axis. But what is his face axis? Here's Alice's time axis. And here's Alice's face axis. What's Bob's face axis? I got Bob's face axis. Yeah. I see it's tilt there. Which direction is it tilt? Like that?
Here's what I do. Okay, that's just one
This one, we find Cleopatra. A velocity for Cleopatra to move at such that those two events happen at her location. We ask the same kind of question. How much time did you last on Cleo's clock between those two events? There are two ways we can do this. We can use, according to Alice and Bob, or sorry, according to Alice, what she would do is she would take this time squared minus this distance. This squared minus this squared square root will give the time on Alice's, sorry, Cleo's clock. And for Bob, what we would do is, this sort of thing, we would draw lines parallel to Bob's time axis. We're making a grid here. We'll draw lines parallel to Bob's time axis, and we will draw lines parallel to Bob's x axis. The diagram is getting a bit messy. Okay, so instead of having a rectangular grid, it's a grid that's kind of stretched down a little bit like that. Okay, and so what he would do is say, according to me, according to my time and my space, I would say that this event over here occurs. I would just follow this line back here and say, this is the amount of time we're talking about. And I would follow this guy back to my space axis. And I would say, this is the amount of space involved. Okay, and so Bob would say, I would take this I squared minus this K squared square root, and I would conclude that that's the amount of time that's my field spot. Okay, so let me get the same amount of time as Alice did. Yes, and that's the whole point. Okay, so time dilation, and as we'll see further, like contraction and so on, those are precisely the right amounts of contraction for time and space, so that Bob will get exactly the same answer as Alice did. When she takes this squared minus this squared, it'll be the same as this squared minus that squared. Okay, that requires time dilation and light contraction. And at the end of the day, what it means is there's a geometry. Okay, so between any two points in space-time, different people can make a measurement of the length of that path. And the length of that path is precisely just physically the time elapsed on a clock. Okay? Just as physical as laying down a meter stick here and saying, yes, I've got a physical meter stick connecting those two. You know, my x and y components might change, but when I go x squared plus y squared square root, I get the same thing. The physical length of that physical meter stick, the physical time elapsed on that physical clock, that the origin is just carrying with her. Okay, so space-time has geometry. This is a hugely important lesson. And this was, as I said, invented by Minkowski. And Minkowski was a teacher of Einstein's, a professor of Einstein's. And he took Einstein's physics and recognized that there's this mathematics behind it. Initially, Einstein thought, that's just whatever, some math, whatever, who cares. But then later on, he started to draw up that there is something really deep in that. The fact that space-time has a geometry. You know, what if that geometry could be warp? You know, and then Einstein figures out later, 10 years later, you know, he figures out that gravity is in fact related to that curve, to a curvature of space-time. All right, so, blah, blah, blah. Let's actually take a look at this picture here. So let me rotate this a little bit. How do I rotate this? Okay, so let me just shut off a couple of these lights. Okay, this is one on, and this one, okay. A bit tighter. All right, so this is interesting picture here. Okay, so I'm gonna try to talk a little bit about this. So what we see here is Alice, we're getting a point of view that Alice is at rest, this is her world mind, and this is her spatial axis. Okay, and along her spatial axis, so this is Alice's spatial axis here, and along her spatial axis, she has a bunch of lights that are mounted, okay, and a different colored lights. So at t equals 0, this is t equals 0, t equals 1, t equals 2, and so on, so as time goes on, her lights are going to be flashing different colors. Okay, so at t equals 0, her lights along this, along her x-axis are first blue, this light is a blue, this light is green, red, blue, or something like that. Okay, and then at t equals 0, t equals 1 second, the lights all change color. Okay, this one changes from blue to red, this one from green to blue, and so on and so forth. Okay, then t equals 2 seconds, it changes color again. So as far as Alice is concerned, what she has is this stick with a bunch of lights on it, these lights are flashing. Okay, all different colors. Okay, and that color pattern you can see is moving to the right. Okay, so this one starts out blue, then the blue moves over there, then the blue moves over there, and so on. So what you'll see is this pattern of three colors moving down her meter stick, repeating all the color pattern. Okay, now let's look at what Bob sees. Okay, so Bob is now moving with respect to Alice. So he's in motion in Alice's space. Okay, and so this one here is at rest, and Bob is moving with respect to that rod. Okay, let's see, so what does he see? Well, there's his time axis like this, and according to what we just talked about, his spatial axis tilts up like this. Okay, so his spatial axis is like this. Okay, so at t equals 0 in Bob's reference frame, that's his x-axis. At t equals 1 in Bob's reference frame, that's his x-axis. And so on, so his x-axis is just moving upward like this as time goes on for Bob. Okay, so at t equals 0 for Bob, what does he see? This is his x-axis. He sees all of the lights along that rod to all be blue. Okay, and then 1 second later, according to him, he sees all of those lights to be red, and then all of them to be green. So on, yeah.
Oh, well, I mean, that's what I'm looking for. I'm repeating a signal, and it's higher than 0.1. How much does this one, an angle that is less than 45 degrees?
A reference frame like this, that's knowledge and kind of weird analysis. What you really need is this sort of unwritten